Okay, we are going to get started. The good news is there's like four families at the research table right now talking spit and mailing sleep watches and all that good stuff. So that's very exciting. But I do want to keep us on schedule. So we have two segments this afternoon and a break. I forgot that I scheduled in a break, but we are doing very well on time, which means... Yeah, either he will screw it up or I'm really pushing Frank out of his comfort zone because, whatever, 16 or 17 ed days that we've been doing this together, and typically he's the low man on the totem pole and gets cut to about a three-minute talk, and today, yeah, how evil I am. And it's true, but it's true. Yeah. Yeah. He gets squeezed every time. Unfortunately, he's also after lunch today, so that's not the most desirable spot. However, I'm not done yet. Yes. Yeah. However, he does have a whole hour. We have a break scheduled. Yeah. So stay awake, people. Now, I do want to comment, though. I'm going to go off on a tangent here quickly. Back to Ed Day number one. I think we were at Gillette Wallace Coal Room, and he challenged us to get enrollees. Yep. More than 50% in the survey. We never made it. Shame on us. So if we would have made 50% of parent participation in his study at that time, the ponytail gets cut, and it never got cut. So that's a major failure on all of us as parents. Enroll. But now here's what I'm thinking, why I brought it up, is we kind of like have ponytail number two. So I think he should set a new goal of participation, because we've heard today from many of us how important that is. Two goals, so we got two ponytails that go. If we meet the goal, I don't know. Think about it. Tell us before we go home. And so, sorry, Frank Symons. This is Frank Symons from the University of Minnesota. He's actually in charge of things at the U, believe it or not. So, very fun guy. He's from Canada. He plays hockey. I've known him all these years. A great guy, and so impress us.
That's there. How about I just end it being, thank you. I don't know. I've never had the situation of how you follow the introduction like that. That's good. I mean, one takeaway from this business is you're, and many of you who do know me know this. I mean, I'm a man without an exit strategy. So, that's what we could be thinking about. What's the bet? But this is lockdown beard. So it hasn't been groomed, attended to since March 20, and I haven't been told to get rid of it yet by my local influencer, my spouse, or my daughter. So, but we could come up with some, I don't know what, 50 spit kits, something, I don't know, then I trim it, I have no idea. Let me just quickly situate myself a little bit with this fantastic introduction. I am at the U, and so I'm an academic. My home academically is in the special ed program. It's part of the Department of Educational Psychology. Same with Brianne and same with Alyssa and pretty much all of us that come out of the U and hang out with the crew at Gillette and MRSA. But I have strayed into the dark side of the academy. I've been in middle management now for some time as in administration as one of the associate deans. In my college, which is education and human development. So I appreciate the opportunity to be here. But as each passing year goes by, I feel less and less relevant. So, hopefully I can say some useful things. But I have to tell you also, tied to Art and Tim and the years of doing this, it was the AM. And they would have, the Gillette docs giving their updates and the U of M giving their updates. And there'd be an hour and a half for that. And then literally get down to 5 minutes left, and then they'd say, well, Frank, you got... And I'd have all these slides meticulously prepared, and I'd have like 2 minutes, and I'd say, well, we're doing stuff. So this morning, seeing the agenda in a full hour, and being the academic I am, and while Lisa was talking this morning, I put this talk together, and to think about filling an hour. And then over lunch, I was picking up a vibe of, yeah, Frank, you know, we're going to start 1:15, and then we got the fun stuff after, so maybe if you could just kind of, you know, condense it and get her down to 20 minutes or something. I'm like, why? I put all these slides together. So I'm very confused. So.
Okay, that was before I came and checked my notes.
Oh.
And we had a full hour plus the break.
Okay.
Before the last segment.
All right. So. All right. So I'm going to be a little academic on you. I mean, I'll try to be practical. So here we go. And I was thinking, I put this, you know, understanding of that. Oh, wait a sec. I don't think of myself certainly not as an expert in Rett, and certainly not in pain. I mean, so let me, where I come from is severe developmental disabilities, and I started and still work in the area of self-injury. So biting, banging your head, scratching, skin picking, all that stuff. And we tried to figure that out, both related to assessment intervention, one kid at a time, but also maybe more basic science related to sensory and risk factors. And that backdoored me into thinking about pain in general. Why would someone self-injure? Isn't it painful? I don't know. How would we find out if it's painful if someone's nonverbal or doesn't have language in a conventional way? So it led me into issues around thinking about how do you get access to a subjective experience like pain in a way that's reliable and valid and scientifically defensible. So that brought me right into the world of Gillette, and with actually Ray Turvo, and then meeting Art, that led eventually to a meeting sitting across a small table in a small conference room with Lisa, where they said, have you thought about Rett, Frank, from Ray and Art? I said, I don't know anything about Rett, and then, well, I'd like you to meet the parent president. And I sat across from Lisa, and I said, what were you hoping we could do? What do you think she said? This is a long time ago. Do you know what you said? Literally? You said, cure it. And I said, what do you think I said?
Okay.
No. I said, I'm not that kind of doctor. I'll come back to that. But you haven't kicked us off the island. So self-injury, pain, and Rett syndrome is how I introduce myself to just about any group. But with that said, you know, this has been a fascinating, important day. I'm glad we're all back together in person. 3 years have been a very long time. And so I have this understanding. I don't know about understanding. It's co-understanding. This for me, with this community in particular, it's very much a two-way street with regard to the way that you think and understand. In this case, I think in this room, daughters, although we know there are boys with Rett too, is as important as to what, certainly to what an academic researcher thinks about it, but also the provider. So there's three people, three sets of perspectives in this group. But let's start with the other important stuff. This is an update slide. This is the Ice Cats. We put a team in every year for the fundraiser, and I want to draw your attention to what we're surrounding, because this is a first for us. Anybody? One of the great trophies in hockey. Maybe the great trophies in hockey. So there we are, up close and personal. Now I want to draw your attention to something. I'm a little off camera. Okay, so look up at the top and note what that is, and then the Ice Cats slipped in the can of hams. We taped it on. I don't think it's permanent. I don't know who the actual keeper of this trophy is, but we did add a can of hams for a little bit. So that was last year. I don't know if we're going to pull it off this summer or not. We'll see. Okay, I got this thing in three chunks. Quickly, I'm going to just set a context for the scientific state of the science with regard to pain and developmental disability, and I want to define this for you. I'm an academic, so we're gonna work on some definitions. And then move into what we know about it at a high level scientifically in Rett, and then take a little bit deeper dive into the research we've been doing. And some of this is new for some of you, and some of it will be repeat, but I thought it might be good just to revisit since we're back in person for the first time in a while. So I went to 2019 before COVID. This is a search engine, PubMed. and I just typed in the terms pain, human, clinical, and in 2019, there's 20,000 publications. Now, those aren't all going to be literally relevant to those three search terms in terms of everything is an empirical study with patients, et cetera, but there's 20,000 plus studies in 2019. If you do the exact same search and add the term developmental disability, you get 64. So the context I'm creating is there is, it's a big sandbox, and there's not a lot of activity scientifically in the problem or issue of pain in general and developmental disorders, developmental disability, neurodevelopmental disability, however you want to phrase that. So let's think a moment here. In 1979, there's a world body of all things on pain, the International Association for the Study of Pain. Through at least 4 years of consensus group meetings, this was the settled and agreed upon definition of pain. And I quote, an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience associated with actual or potential tissue damage or described in terms of such damage. What this definition led to is a saying, a almost proverbial saying, of pain is what the patient says it is. And there's nothing wrong, good or bad, inherently in that, but pain is what the patient says it is. So where do you think the problem lies for what we're interested in and the folks that you live and care for? What's the problem? Right. It's biased towards self. Self-report's the gold standard, right? So they added a clause. Whoop. The inability to communicate in no way negates the possibility that an individual is experiencing pain is in need of appropriate pain-relieving treatment. Pain is always subjective. So the idea that if even absent self-report, it doesn't mean that pain isn't there. But there's a bias inherent in that. So many, many years later, new definition of pain, 2020. Definition was revised to an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience associated with or resembling that associated with actual potential tissue damage. Let me just go back. Actual potential resembling that. That's 20 plus years later. That's 1979 to 2020. They changed two words. That took 5 years to figure out on consensus panels. So, but they kept the clause. They made it a little more detail, and that's kind of small, with one of six clauses reiterating, verbal description is only one of several behaviors to express pain. Inability to communicate does not negate the possibility that a human or non-human animal experiences pain. So here's where I get a little bit, cranky, I guess. What I don't like, I like to move around, and I'm mindful of the camera. I still don't like, they talk about inability to communicate. I don't like that, right? That's not the same as saying somebody's nonverbal or nonvocal, right? Inability to communicate. You know your daughters, they have the ability to communicate in all sorts of ways. And so there's still this thing grinding out of my two cents work, that maybe this works in theory, but less so in practice, where there's still a remarkable set of implicit biases about who and who doesn't experience pain. And there's lots of issues conceptually and theoretically and also practically about that, of gaining access to a subjective experience where the gold standard has and continues to be self-report. So this is the last bit on kind of the science of those 68 studies in 2019, and over the last decade, maybe there's been 300, if you went over the same period of time in the non-DD pain world, there's probably been cumulatively 400,000. So this is not a new statement for me, there's been a few groups, and we've been one of them, working quasi-independently, trying to figure out what I characterize as building a better mousetrap, meaning coming up with ways to assess and measure, those are not synonyms, but assess and measure, so I'll flip it, measure and assess pain in across the lifespan, child, adolescent, adult, in which gaining access to the subjective experience of pain is tricky. And I think in your folder there are a couple of scales, and that'll be the practical, hopefully useful part of me being up here. I thought we could just take a look at these together. But not yet. I got time. I got time. I'm going to take the deep academic dive yet. This is just the icing on the cake. So there's lots of scales out there, but that is one thing. And I just want to make sure we know about them before we leave here. Some of you will already, but some of you won't. And so the mousetrap metaphor is, so if there's more scales that have been either repurposed from other vulnerable populations or built new, what's scientifically not clear to me after about a decade's worth of that work, and that's a decade ago, maybe ending 5 years ago, again, of these scales showing up in the research literature, and then what I am not clear on, I guess, on the knowledge transfer side or knowledge implementation of, are they being used? So is there, if we're building better mousetraps, are there more mice being caught? It's not clear to me how deeply these scales have been penetrating into practice and being used routinely in the course of care. So that's a set of issues for I think the academic and clinical communities. There's my, have we caught more mice? And then, you know, it's consistent with the morning of Rett lives squarely along the translational pipeline of preclinical to clinical and clinical care. And if we think about pain, there is a lot of preclinical bench work around molecules and circuits and brain, a lot of models, meaning mice primarily, right? And all that stuff. And the important part of that work in part for pain is that pain isn't one thing. So we have this very global subjective definition related to an experience, and at the same time, when we look at it biologically, there are different types of pain. And that's part of, and I'll come back to that in the work in Rett, of how to think about source and underlying possibility of, you know, the why, the mechanism, the reason there's pain in the first place, and how to tease that apart when someone isn't able to say it's burning, it's tingling, it's prickling, it's here, it's there. But that's, for me, part of the scientific piece that we're interested in trying to take on is trying to differentiate that there's probably different kinds of pain in individuals living with Rett. And the advances from the bench in pain basic research, I pay attention to because I'm an importer. It's like, can we bring that into the way what we're doing? With regard to the studies that we're doing. And that leads into some of the promises of trying to figure out what is this thing called pain, is biomarkers. The issue with biomarkers, so, you know, saliva, you know, what are we doing with that? In this case, we're looking at DNA and whether it's methylated or not, so whether there's ways of regulating DNA being expressed. But biomarkers in general, the reason we think we like them is, quote, they're objective, right? They're accessible through blood or saliva, skin. Some of you have participated. We've taken little bits of skin from your daughter. So we're looking for very specific markers that relate to pain and sensory and immune. On the other hand, the conundrum for biomarkers is, quote, a biomarker is not an assessment of how an individual feels, functions, or survives, right? So it doesn't have anything to do with the subjective side of life in general or pain in particular. And there's many colleagues in my field broadly that conflate experience and expression. So the absence of expression or expression that may be ambiguous or blunted gets treated like then the experience is absent, right? And they're not the same thing. And it's the same with what this is saying in terms of biomarkers. We won't see pain in a dish, right? When we're measuring levels of cortisol because we're interested in stress and your daughter's ability to... Does it follow a certain cycle? That's important, but it's not the same as saying that's pain or she or he doesn't feel pain. So, and people slip down that slope often of thinking that they're measuring pain when they're measuring biomarkers. So this is my last wrap up on that state of the science slide when I read the studies that have been done. I mean, there's just a lot of work, and this isn't going to be anything new to you all. There's a lot of unknowns on postoperative. This is, again, in the context of severe neurodevelopmental disability where using spoken language is not an option in terms of the patient, the individual. So there are a host of unattended clinical and research opportunities and issues around postoperative pain management, decision-making about pain management, pain assessment, communication, non-pharm approaches, and repeated procedural pain. Okay, so now I'm one-third through. Am I doing all right? Okay. I know, and the after lunch crowd, it's tough too, because it's the academic, stretch. If you feel you're drifting off, think of the ponytail or something. When we got involved with Rett, we tried to get up to speed quickly, and we've heard of the Godfather already. I guess that's Alan, Dr. Percy. This, what do we call Uta, the godmother? She's the rock star. Alan doesn't get you. Both are rock stars. So as I encountered the world of Rett through Gillette and the families and trying to get up to speed, there were two big areas, right? There's the natural history study we've heard a lot about, and there's a lot of work preclinically at the level of the bench, whether it's at proteins and molecules or cells or circuits. And that's not really what we do. So our time was spent trying to think of, can't cure it, how are we going to be useful in some way as the scientist part of this equation? And so for much of our program of work, if it's not necessarily been applied right now, it's informed by thinking about that in between kind of the 20,000 foot snapshot and the molecular mechanisms of what happens if the gene is mutated for brain development, is what to do right now about behavior and communication and health issues. And that's back to the original survey. The survey we sent out a long, long time ago were simply standard scales, basically to find out what was of concern most to the family group at that time for Minnesota. It's now expanded to Midwest, but at that time for the Minnesota group, to help organize us of what we're going to try to see where we could be most helpful. That's where this came from. And from it, this is non-quantitative, but the little green wedge is probably the relative amount of work empirically, scientifically, that gets done in Rett at least a few years ago relative to all of the basic science and everything else. There isn't a lot of what I would characterize as applied, behavioral, special ed, that kind of oriented work of therapies, if you want to use that term, relative to the majority of the work. So I'll go back and be consistent with that initial PubMed. So same search terms, right? But then I add Rett syndrome, and I stay with 2019. There were 10. 10's pretty good. It's kind of, I don't know if it's trending down, but 10's good when you think about what the number was. It was 68, I think. So there's been some activity. Our group's been part of that story. There's a group in Italy. Some of the Australians are in and out of it. So it's part of the conversation, which is scientifically, which is a good thing. But there's a lot more to go. So the rationale for what we're up to on this part of our, remember, what to do with communication, behavior, health, is at least in three different ways I think about it. It's still how to recognize, what are we going to say? There's pain for any one person or patient, and what to do about it remains poorly understood. The complication of numerous chronic health problems, seizures, scoliosis, et cetera. It's not unique to Rett, but it's a common feature that doesn't occur in all of the different groups that we sometimes work with, where there is and it goes back to one of the original clinical reports by Rett himself, and a couple of other very important clinicians making those initial observations of remarks about apparent insensitivity to pain. And one of the through lines from those early observations is a general set of, I don't know if their beliefs, I don't know if they're, I don't think they're biases, but beliefs or a general sense that pain is diminished in individuals living with Rett syndrome. And in one sense, that's partly for us, one of the things we're trying to figure out, like, is it really? How would we know? We need to know because it has consequences for how pain is managed. And again, a little soapbox, in general, historically, in severe neural developmental disabilities, the standard operating procedure bias has been pain is not a problem in severe disabilities, and it's a little bit if you can't measure it, you can't manage it, and we don't believe it's there because they're not expressing it or they're not capable of, and all sorts of things. If you go back not too far back in our collective history of our understanding and care of individuals with severe developmental disorders. So I come from that perspective of sociopolitical. There are long histories of biased beliefs about they don't feel pain, they don't suffer, et cetera. And that's not where anybody's coming from, but I have that historical perspective. And so encountering this literature when we got involved with this about a decade ago is there is a through line about this belief that pain is diminished. Either girls are insensitive or indifferent. And so that's another part of what we're trying to figure out scientifically to be useful. And in all these cases, these three bins that overlap, it leads to diagnostic uncertainty. So the real experts like Art that have to figure out what to do, there's a lot of uncertainty. And so Art himself, we've been working with him at trying to figure out an algorithm to guide his clinical point of care bedside decision-making in a way that he doesn't have the luxury that we do as academic clinical researchers. So the approach that we're trying to take, and our own Brianne Byers wrote a comment on a paper on assessing pain in cerebral palsy was the context. But, you know, this is no big insight, but we're going to need an integrated approach that cuts across biology, psychology, and the social context of pain. And this is my last academic-y, and then I'm just going to give you an update on what we've been doing in the projects. It's helpful to break apart pain in at least three ways. You could do it in different ways, but this way has been very helpful for at least for me in my thinking about it. Where there's pain sensation, right, nociception, that's the biology side of things. The sensation part where the nervous system is engaged and the periphery is talking to the central nervous system upstairs to the brain. There's pain expression, or rather perception, pardon me, the pain experience itself. And then there is expression, pain behavior. So all of the scales and stuff I mentioned, that the build a butter mousetrap, we're all us too, and that's what we're gonna just go through one time practically. That's what they're measuring, right? It's not about being honest with ourselves, but about being clear. We're getting some measure of expression, presumably maybe also burden of what an individual is living with, particularly we're thinking about chronic pain. But we're measuring behavior, either directly or indirectly. Some of the work we've been doing, this is where the biomarkers work, is over there, of getting after biomarkers that relate to the biological systems that regulate a noxious stimulus, by definition, tissue damaging, right? And these are tricky and slippery things. It doesn't mean that somebody who's had a noxious experience is necessarily experiencing pain. They're not the same. But there's information in any one of these three things. And I think where we want to get is pain experience. What's somebody feeling? And that's the trick of it. So basically, we're just trying to, we want to get here, but it's really, really hard in terms of access to that subjective experience. So we're trying to work around it, both on the biology side and the measurement of behavior, the pain burden, pain expression. So this is the way we've oriented the program of work that's been funded on and off locally, a little bit from MRSF in the past, and the feds, NIH, where if the goal is to improve comfort or reduce pain, I would characterize the problem of pain in Rett as a problem of access. Right? That's how I shifted it. It's not a problem of they don't feel pain. It's a problem of access. How do we get access to the subjective experience? That middle part, right? And we're going to get there by being really careful about measuring pain behavior or the biomarkers and see if things stick together, right? If it walks like a duck, quacks like a duck, might be a duck. So what does pain look like in Rett, and what are the pain mechanisms? And I'm just going to quickly go through this. What we've been doing, it's we can think about symptoms. These are the rating scales, and there's examples in your packet of we can measure. We don't think of them so much as symptoms, but that's behavior, nonverbal rating scales. We can look at signs. So to the degree of symptoms, we think about subjective signs, objective. We have worked on developing a pain examination procedure that we pair with a rating scale where we're looking for how people are reacting in terms of behavior in relation to the exam. We have been looking at sensory features. Some of you have had your daughter more than once in this thing we call MQST, where we've modified a quantitative sensory test. And that sensory test we've imported from clinical neurology, where it starts getting at that idea of there's different kinds of pain. There's different kinds of sensory profiles as it relates to mechanical, thermal, pinprick, all that stuff. And we modified it so that it's not language dependent. So but as Breanne said, I mean, we're all about measurement. So our focus is on using these things, but not necessarily in a way that art needs right now of does it help me or not. It's we need to understand the measurement properties of when we repeat them, do we still get the same profile or how much variability there is? And would they ever be useful both at point of clinical care or as an outcome on these trials that are coming, right? Which is absolutely amazing. Compared to, you know, again, when we got involved, there weren't these trials, and we were thinking we had the luxury of time about maybe these things would be useful outcome measures, and now we're in it. And, you know, we're in this, too, of different phases of how confident we are in some of our measures being useful for trial outcome measures. Biomarkers for us, for those, some of you who've been in this, saliva's been one, you know, spit on a stick, that was our term for it at the state fair. And or if you've helped us out with the skin biopsy work, that's why we're doing this. And then some of you may remember a while back with the FLIR cameras doing infrared thermal. So that's what we're doing and why. We're trying to gather as much information as we can that we think is relevant to this, you know, construct. And so a lot of our studies are trying to relate these measures to one another. Do they go together or don't they? What can we discard? What can we get down to? The sensory features, the skin biopsy, and the autonomic thermal is a big one. Because we have these observations that just jump out at us, right? That's a thermal image. I don't have to tell you that's not typical, but there's information in that, right? So typically for all of us, the symmetry on both any side of the body with regard to thermal is relatively constant. Clearly, that's not the same. So we have these initial clinical observations we're making that we quantify. We've done it in green there, that shag carpet. You've seen this slide. Some of you this slide before. That's from a skin biopsy from a patient, a participant with Rett. Made the cover of Brain and Behavior a few years ago. So that was good for this community, for the research side. But that's what we're interested in, the 1970 shag carpet, right? The little green guys are nerves. Well, how does that relate to the thermal? Living with that thermal dysregulation locally. You know, everybody's in the brain. I get that. I'm a periphery guy. Of that local condition with regard to the way the nerves work and the vascular, the vein, the blood in there, those all talk to one another. And in other conditions, there's a lot of pain riding along when you see thermal images like that. But those are the conditions where the patients can talk. And so those are the things I'm poking around at, trying to figure out what to do with it. So the last takeaway on this, and then I'll jump to the scales, is just over time when we started, we didn't have the currency in the realm for us as the science side to keep our lights on is peer-reviewed publications and federal research grants. And you can't have one until you have, you know, to get one, you need the paper trail. So what we've been busy doing of, you know, what do you guys do at the U all day? Well, besides sitting in a lot of meetings because of my administrative wanderings, we make observations, right? We try to make sense of them, and then we write them up, and we disseminate them. So this is just a quick snapshot of it's been a busy, good, busy time. Alyssa's been a key driver. Breanne obviously is at the helm here, and I'm kind of in the background of creating knowledge out of this clinic that you guys had the foresight to create and maintain, and has permitted us to jump in and find out a lot of stuff and share it with the scientific community globally. So That's a good news. Now, I'm going to end not on a bad news, but a launch into. So let me just take a quick deeper dive of, and it ties back into the third part of our program of work and the way I think about it for Rett and pain, is this is a study in which we were going off electronic health records at all girls, so controlling for sex, same age band, same surgical procedure for, so same treatment and same condition, scoliosis, so spinal fusion, three groups, you know, to show you the data, but just prepping you for it. So I can't do a talk like this without at least two data slides. But I'm going to link it back into the, if not the beliefs or a bias, just there's still some issues to continue to chip away at with regard to pain and, in this case, post-operative care. So we went through charts, post-spinal fusion, inpatient, day zero through, I think, seven or eight. And looking, again, same sex, same procedure, same condition, same hospital. Looking at the analgesic load, so how was pain being managed analgesically post-surgery? And so one group was adolescent idiopathic scoliosis. So girls, quote-unquote, typically developing with scoliosis. Another group, living with cerebral palsy, scoliosis that led to this treatment. And then the third group was girls living with Rett with scoliosis. So on the left, there's two chunks to this. On the left is the analgesic dosing. And this is a little small, I apologize. This dark filled circles of girls with Rett. These are averages. We collapse. There's more than one in this group. And typical developing is the open circles. And then closed squares are girls living with cerebral palsy. So this is how much pain is being managed analgesically. And these are bedside by nurses pain ratings. Okay, postoperatively after spinal fusion for scoliosis. So two things of note. Right away, this is postoperative day. Right away, the girls with red are getting less analgesia than the girls with cerebral palsy, another developmental disability condition, if you want to give me that, and girls without a developmental disability. So they're being treated the same postoperatively for their pain. The girls with Rett were not. And other than the immediate postoperative day, well, the day zero, the ratings of pain are the same. In fact, you could say at the end, they're going up. So bedside ratings of pain, other than that one blip, are comparable across these groups. Those aren't any significant differences until right at the end, being rated with more pain. And yet the analgesic story is the analgesia is going down. It was never the same as for the other two groups, and yet their pain was rated the same. So that concerns me, because back to that diagnostic uncertainty, nobody's good or bad in this argument, but the issue is why those decisions are being made. And in anecdotal ways, my concern is that one point I made. There's a belief that the girls with Rett don't feel pain. And some of you are probably thinking of some of the questionnaires you've ever completed or interviews you've had with us. Well, we're asking you about, you know, what's been in the last week, good day, bad day, or pain, no pain. And there is this kind of conundrum where there's a sense that she doesn't feel pain the way other people feel pain. It might be less. But then if we turn around and ask, well, in the past week, there have been things that would be painful, the answer is almost always yes. So that's kind of active right now of what we're trying to understand. And I'll put it this way, and then I'll go to the scales. Whoops. Where I think, you know, chronic pain, pain burden, pain mechanisms, the biology stuff. I think a lot of our scales and questions and measurement, we're trying to, you know, we're characterizing the burden, what it looks like and how it interferes with life. We know less about this, and I want to start making the argument. We need to figure this out, I think, because I think people, the practice community at large, if they had some evidence that these things are active, it might help convince them in ways that are different than some of our other measurement approaches that pain needs to be attended to in this population, just like in other populations in which self-report or communication is complex. Then that's back. So how do you get at mechanisms? Quantitative sensory testing, brain imaging, peripheral nerves, pharm, genetics. And so I'm an importer. This is from regular pain world. That's what we're trying to do. We've modified QST. Every now and then we do the skin biopsy because that's getting at this side of chronic pain. So there's no end to that. I don't have a good feel-good takeaway other than that's trying to characterize what we're doing and why. Okay, so let me just fast forward. I had a Captain Obvious in there. In your handout, you have, I don't know exactly what you have. I know you, Lisa put something in. Oh, yeah. The first one is called the pain inventory. Yeah, pain profile. Okay. So there's a, Gillette with, has a designated clinical research area in pain and comfort led by Chantel Burkett, Dr. Barney, Dr. Burkett, who has created a toolbox for Gillette. So when you encounter Art, too, or any provider there, you can ask them about the Gillette pain toolbox or bring up, you know, I think there's ways to download these scales. And I'm just trying to think of the features of the two, the pain inventory and the, okay, pain profile. So the pain inventory is one, the first one there in the packet, I don't know if I have it right up. I wasn't sure the order of these. This is, I'll just slip into, you know, this is one we like. And we like it because it's very helpful in that it's not so much as getting into the dance of is it pain, isn't it pain. It's a judgment about, usually, you know, the recall is over the period of a week, of your judgment and sense of where pain is interfered. And so it's kind of across activities of daily living, sleep, enjoyment of life, rec activities, does not interfere, completely interfere, 0 to 10. We've used this a lot in our clinical research studies, back to the measurement side, the measurement properties we like, meaning it produces scores that tend to be very reliable. And they tend to be reliable over time, and they can also change when there's intervention. So that's important as an outcome measure. So the brief pain inventory, everything for us almost involves a modified brief for whatever we put in front of it for modifying it for individuals first who aren't self-reporting. It's relying on proxy, meaning you all, reporting on behalf of your daughters. And this scale is, these are all very straightforward, right? Just 0 to 10 of a judgment. It's all good. Judgment's good. Of your best bet of degree of interference to not at all to extreme. And over, say, a week. Could be a day. It could be a week. Let me back up. Because I think the next one, I was importing these from Chantel's slide deck. I wasn't exactly sure what I had. I want to draw our attention to Gillette Toolbox. Yeah, that's what you have right there, the pain inventory. So they put together a set of documents that get at judgment of pain in terms of 0 to 10, then a modified brief pain inventory, and this pain profile right here. So this is an easy one to look up. It's the pediatric pain profile. It exists online, and you can download the forms. And there are a bunch of features to this that do three things. It lets you, and we talked a little bit this morning, it came up about the importance of baselines. Think that way too, that what you're doing is collecting information in a baseline-like way. And the pediatric pain profile does three things really well. It has a standalone document about what, in this case, your daughter's, what a good day looks like. This is all in regard to pain. So a pain-free day. What does that look like? And there's all these items. I'm not going to work through each item. There's all these items to anchor your judgment, your best guess, your own knowledge of what's a good day that's pain-free or relatively pain-free look like. And then it has another dot form that looks the same, but it's about bad day. On a bad day, what does she look like in regard to the things that you go off that you rely on as indicators from her that she's having a bad day. Again, in a judgment about maybe something's bothering her in terms of pain or distress or uncomfort or whatever term you want to use. So you can get a profile start to get built in a diary-like way of what a good day looks like and what a not-so-good day looks like, all, again, in relation to pain. Also in that Gillette packet, again, right, is information about interference. So on bad days, and you're also rating interference of, there's lots of things she's not able to do on bad days. On good days, she looks like this, and there's very little interference. So it's documenting that. And then what you can, the scores are easy. They add up. They sum up of judgments, zero to threes. And then there are ways to plot that with the pediatric pain profile. This is you guys doing this, a little, you know, at home over the week or 2 weeks or whatever period of time needs to be, where in this case, pain A, pain B, and then it lets you break down different forms that you think of pain that might be on board. Okay? GI, I know, is a big one, but other forms of pain. And what it can do, I'm just going to, you know, is when you show up at Gillette, is create a context for communication that's maybe a little different than saying she's in pain, or I know something's been bothering her, or something doesn't seem right. This gives you, it's not more objective, but it gives Art more to go on with the conversation with you. And it'd be reasonable to wonder, well, because there's other pain scales I mentioned. We've been building mousetraps. So which pain scale? And my answer now over the last few years is there, even though I'm advocating, you know, I like the pediatric pain profile. That's what they built in at Gillette into this toolbox. I like that brief pain inventory. To me, the answer could also be pick one. There's also the non-communicating children's pain checklist revised. There's the thing called the FLAC, which is really simple, that's been revised for people living with severe neurodevelopmental disabilities. It's just rating face, leg. What's the activity, cry, consolability for FLAC? Which scale? Pick a scale. Because what they do, probably more importantly than saying, I think it's a 6, and then Art says, that's a 5 to me, you know, that's not what they're there for, right? It's the same when you go into a doctor. If you're, you know, I took a puck in my head at Brandon's tournament, come in, and, you know, they want to know what my pain is right then at triage, right? If I'm smart, I know to say over 4 if I want something analgesic. But these scales aren't about saying, I think it's a 4, and Art says, I think it's a 3. It's about creating the context for a conversation about what you're seeing. And you're in a better position if you've used, I think, it's an argument, used this, one of these scales, because they have anchors that make you think a little bit about, yeah, it's this, not that. And I'm seeing it more and more this way, right? More and more. I've got data. Like, it isn't, in my mind, it's going up. Over the past 2 weeks, this. That's helpful information for Art or Tim or for a PM&R doc or for a rehab therapist or a pain specialist. That's a better starting point than I think something's wrong or, I don't know, 0 to 10, 7? You know, this gives more information that green line is something's tried and then you can chart it. You know, it didn't get worse, you know, or maybe it got better. So the way I think about using these are think about, you know, individualizing for, and it's not, I'm not saying so going forward every day of every week you're always doing this. It could be that there's a reason to start doing it. And then when that happens, get a little bit scientific, right? Pick same time every day for a week. We're going to look at it this way. Or multiple times, but get systematic, introduce some systematicity to how you're recording information, what signs are present, and the scales all have similar properties of different ways that we all express pain, whether it's verbal, body, positioning, protecting, moaning, groaning, screaming. All of them have these properties. They just set up a little bit differently. But that's what, you know, pick how often and when, how often, can I be roughly in the same time? and I'll individualize it in terms of good day, bad day, or whatever, like pediatric pain profile, track before and after. So you get the Gillette, maybe it's over the phone, virtual, or in person, and then you're home, keep going with it to see how you were rating before and how you're rating after. Try to keep things the same, and is there any difference? And that's going to be useful for, on the clinical side of yes or no, because that's going to help inform decision-making, and depending on, you know, really getting worse versus really getting better or staying the same, it's going to help with those guided provider discussions and decisions. Okay. I'm gonna stop right. Well, I could take questions too, but I'm just trying to get a little ahead of the time. All right. I think that's what I got. Okay, that's all I got. How about that?
All right. Okay, put those charts back up.
Oh.
Are there any questions? Stump Frank. Come on, let's put him on the spot. No questions. I have two things then that, well, kind of a question comment. So back to the handout. So your invite had indicated Chantal Barney Burkett was going to be presenting, and she's, if you have questions. Chantal could not be here today. She's part of the Gillette team, actually started under Frank with her schooling and early days. But anyway, so tools in your toolbox is all that is. That was developed by her and the Gillette team. And yes, exactly what he said is we're hoping to provide you something that probably many of us, I know I do it with Jill and I've done it for years, of tracking like certain things every day. But when now you get into like a funny zone, like for us, it was gallbladder that led to gallbladder removal. That was hell. 8 weeks of extreme pain. I don't even like to think about what she had to go through. And we were doctoring a lot with Dr. Bising to get through that. But when you get into that kind of moment, or these GI flare-ups, and is it menstrual cycle, or what is it? But using that stuff for this, your own peace of mind, am I making this up? Was it really that bad? But that usefulness when you go meet at Rett Clinic, something to get that conversation going, get to the point faster. Because again, Dr. Bising, Dr. Fima, they don't know our kids inside and out. They don't live with them. Help them navigate to a meaningful conversation faster that leads to helping your kid. So it is just a tool. It's not a be-all, end-all. You mentioned there's other stuff out on the web or whatever else you might want to do, but that's the point of that. Now, I want to clarify. Go back to your slide when you did the study of the Gillette patients and the typically developing the CP and the Rett. I'm going to try to make sense of what he was talking about just for my own clarity, but maybe it'll help you guys too. Because my daughter went through spinal fusion at Gillette. How many else? I know many of us did. Here we are. So let's pretend these are our daughters. So help me. I might have misunderstood this. So you're saying this is our daughters that raised your hand in the room. We all had daughters that had spinal fusion at Gillette. So here's Jill in this group. One, I'm assuming that, well, she might not really be in this group, but let's just assume. One, I'm assuming that she's dosed here because that's some standard in the books. That's what they gave her for pain management because they had to start somewhere. Where these kids that could talk got more.
One group could talk, one group not.
Okay. But why are they higher? My guess is because they can speak and say, yeah, that's not enough. Give me more. Okay, our girls didn't get that. That's sad to me. Although, but I'm going somewhere with this. But then over here, now we have the nurse. Not to discount at all the mom that was with the daughter the whole time. Okay, but the nurse is, this is weird to me that the nurse is seeing some things, but we're not reacting to any new medication that's just following a path. It still stayed below. So I understood this. Yay. So my point that I wanted to make is, yeah, you got this nurse, and yes, you have this protocol of how to dose a standard textbook case on spinal fusion for pain, but damn it, we're all parents and we know our kids best. So make sure when you see stuff like that happening, they're trying their best, but pain in nonverbal is tough.
Tricky, because
And I want to...
These are opioids, right?
Yeah.
So there's a... professional wisdom of being careful on dosing when you, you know, of...
And you don't want to overdose, right?
I'm not going to defend the 8 weeks of hell that I didn't do any quicker here.
Oh, but, no. We did our best, but it was...
Yeah, it's always a challenge. So when you're in the hospital, you've got somebody who's written a prescription for you can have X amount of narcotics. And then you've got a mother at the bedside, and it's father sometimes, but a few more mothers, and the nurse. And at Gillette, we're very lucky because our nurses have done so many of these posterior spinal fusion surgeries and managed that they're much better than a lot of other places. But what they've learned at Gillette is they better listen to the parents too. And so if that parent says, my child's in pain, they're gonna think about what the order, how the order is written, what can they give them to take care of that. So this is a very complicated triad that, you know, we're measuring one thing, which is the opioids. But what we really, if we were going to do this again, it would be nice to get the parent perception, the nurse perception, and what was written for. But this is a good start. It was a good study to do, I think.
Yeah, well, it's reality.
And and I'm just going to interject, it is not uncommon to come to clinic and say there is something wrong. What is it? And I like to use the term distressing symptom because I don't know if it's pain, I don't know if it's anxiety or what it is. So a while back I wrote a little thing on what questions doctors are going to ask you by system when you come in for distressing symptoms. So that's something else we could get out also. Because I think when you're sitting at home at 3 a.m. worried, thinking about what is going on, it's kind of nice to go through a list and be able to check some things off. But we can talk about that later. I didn't want Frank to talk the whole time because... And I did tell him that I have a drooling talk we could do if we wanted to cut him off over there in the PowerPoint. Okay.
Thank you very much. So, yes, my point of all that, one, I understand it, but two, never underestimate your voice and your opinion as a parent, period.